Welcome, it's Jeremy Allen Gould. I'm coming to you today to confirm between God and of man that in fact, the rumors that you have all heard are true. I started this podcast because I freaking love music. I was privileged enough to book amazing artists and bands in the past, and I was lucky enough to stay in touch with many of them to this day. This is a place to hear their stories. Thank you so much for riding along on this journey, and I hope you enjoy what you hear. With that said, the rumors are definitely true. Walk into flames that you start with yourselves. It can help while you can to pull meat from bones. Bend down your home. Create a divergent jump by yourself. Time to give thanks to the ones who are.
Thank you for tuning into this latest episode of the Rumors Are True podcast. My name is Jeremy. Today, I welcome my friend Phil Chamberlain. You know Phil from the bands To Speak of Wolves, Sullivan, and This Runs Through. Phil and I have an awesome conversation about him growing up and getting into music, talking about his first bands, as well as all the records and tours he's been on throughout his illustrious career. Awesome conversation. It was really cool to reconnect with an old friend. Really hope you enjoy this episode as much as I did. So without further ado, this is the episode with Phil Chamberlain. Phil Chamberlain, what's up, buddy? Thanks so much for coming on my podcast.
Jeremy, man, always great to hear from you, and thanks for having me, of course.
Absolutely, man. What's going on in your life now, man? It's been a while since we've talked, but just tell me what's going on in your life.
Man, well, I'm a dad now. I've got two boys and an amazing wife, and yeah, I've kind of been in dad mode for the last couple years. I've got a 3-year-old and a 1-year-old, so kind of perpetually exhausted, but having a blast. Man, yeah, I mean, like the real, real condensed version of it is, you know, my wife and I had lived in St. Petersburg, Florida for a while, and COVID shut everything down, and we started having babies, and we just felt like, you know, what's the opposite of living at a city on the beach, you know, in a city by the beach? Well, let's go to a little town in the mountains, but not be too far away from people we know and that kind of thing. So we found a house on the internet that we liked, and we moved into a town and kind of on the border of North Carolina and Tennessee that neither one of us had ever been to and had never heard of. And we just thought it would be fun. And, turns out we'll never leave, you know.
I mean, that's amazing.
Anyway, we freaking love it. We're about 30 minutes outside of Asheville, North Carolina, which is a super cool town anyway.
Yeah.
And man, small town life is where it's at. And I never thought I would say that, dude. It's so cool. Like, the mayor lives on the same road that I live on, you know, in our neighborhood. And
that's cool.
It's just crazy, you know, like, you know, the guy that owns the coffee shop and he's a buddy, and you play golf with the guy that owns the brewery and stuff, you know.
That's cool.
Pretty cool, man. We're loving it. It's great.
Like you said, you're 30 minutes from Asheville, so the shows go there, so you're not too far off the beaten path, and you know.
Yeah, just saw my brother and those guys maybe a month ago.
Yeah,
they played the arena in Asheville, and it was awesome.
That's cool.
Yeah. And we're not too far from Atlanta, actually, either. So
yeah, I was gonna say because my wife and I go to Gatlinburg, and I know it's on the other side of that, so it's not too far from there. So
yeah, literally the Smoky Mountain National Park. One side of it is Gatlinburg, and the other side of it is where I live. So
that's
if you just keep driving that main road the two there, you'd eventually wind up where I am.
That's sick. Sick.
Yeah, it's super cool.
So what are you doing work-wise? Tell me what's going on there.
So my day job, I'm a senior project manager for a digital marketing and design firm and based out of Raleigh, North Carolina. One of my best friends in the world started the company many years ago, and I worked there kind of off and on for the last, almost 10 years. But kind of in between touring and stuff, bounce around to various, as funny as it sounds, corporate roles. I've told the story many times, but Sullivan, we had a great manager, Ryan Downey. You may remember him.
Yeah.
And for a little while, I worked for him. As his daily operations guy, and worked for his touring company as well for a little bit. And I kind of learned a lot from him, and we were involved in some really early on, like Facebook ads campaigns and stuff before anybody could advertise on Facebook, some of the really early on ones. And I took a lot of notes, and I just tried to remember a lot of stuff, and found myself in some pretty cool roles over the years.
That's cool.
I ran a few digital marketing departments down in Florida for a handful of insurance companies for many years before COVID shut that down. And it's been interesting. I did a few tours where I actually held down a quote unquote day job, from my laptop.
That's cool.
Which was cool. Yeah.
That's dope, dude. Sweet, yeah. Man. Let's talk about how you and I met.
I should throw in real quick. I own two apparel companies.
I thought you were going to say something, but I went.
Blue Ridge Thread Company. It's like an eco-friendly outdoor brand, inspired by living here in the mountains where we live. And when I was a kid, I did a program here called Outward Bound, where you go and like live in the woods and sleep on the ground for a month and use a compass and a map and drink out of creeks and stuff. It's super cool. It was crazy, to do at 15 or 16 years old, but it was definitely made a lifelong impression on me. So I've always loved this area, and just moved here and started doing, like beanies and t-shirts and that kind of like band merch thing never really leaves you, once you have
absolutely.
It. And just started kind of doing it on the side for fun. We'll do like events here in town and stuff like that. And I play a lot of golf, so I have a side company where I make golf shirts, just kind of like kept blossoming a little bit here in the area. And now they're carrying my products in a couple stores around here. And it's pretty cool, man. Cool. It's pretty cool. Pretty fun. It's almost like being in a band, but just doing the t-shirts or just doing the hats, no records.
Oh yeah. Well, go ahead and name those companies real quick so you can, it's Blue Ridge Thread Company. And what was the other one?
Blue Ridge Thread Company and Smoky Mountain Golf Company.
Very cool.
Yeah. So just both of them are inspired by living here, and they're kind of those kind of designs on the shirts and stuff, but it's really fun. Felt like it'd be something if it takes off, maybe I can leave to my two boys, if they want to do it when they're older, or something like that.
Absolutely. Yeah. Very cool. Very cool. And I like the shirt you're wearing. That's cool. I love that.
Oh, thanks, man.
Sweet, man. Well, let's go back to when you and I first met. It had to be probably, 06. 05, 04. I don't know. I don't even know, to be honest with you.
Well, if it was the first Showbread tour, if that was the first time, which it was, that was the first time we met. It was on that first Showbread tour. So that would have been 06.
That's what I thought.
Yeah. That would have been the year that Hamma Ghost came out. And that came out in I think it was January of 06.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. I was going to say, I wound up booking you guys with Showbread. Who else was on that tour? Do you know? I don't remember. I know. It all just goes together.
There was an Equal Vision band called Versus the Mirror.
Yes, absolutely. I love those dudes. I've looked them up a ton too.
Yeah, they were super cool. I think they were from Tucson.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep. Arizona area. Yep.
And I can't remember who else was on that tour. I've got the laminate laying around somewhere. I'll have to go find it.
Yeah, send me a picture later. I'm curious. It's been so long. But, yeah, absolutely. That was such a cool show. I vividly remember parts of it, which was cool. And I think I wound up booking you guys a couple more times with a Classic Crime and maybe on your own as well. But always loved having you guys come through. You guys were always so sweet and kind. And I just loved working with you guys. It was awesome.
We did too. Yeah. Wichita was always, man, those shows at Eagles Lodge were so sweaty and crazy and fun. And yeah, that was great.
I know.
Yeah, we definitely came through with Showbread multiple times.
Yeah, I think so.
Classic Crime times.
I know I'm really bummed at myself that I didn't keep over the, you know, in that time I didn't keep a detailed. Well, I had it all on MySpace, and that's just non-existent, you know. So it's like I had it there, and now I can't even remember half of the bands I put. So anyway, Phil, let's talk about growing up for you. What it was like, and how music kind of came into your life, and maybe some bands, records, influences that kind of creeped in, and maybe when you started to play drums for the first time.
Yeah. So I grew up in a town called Greensboro, North Carolina. It's pretty much just like right in the middle of the state. Probably like a Wichita sized town, you know, not a small town, not a big city. One of those places that when we were growing up, we couldn't wait to leave, you know, got to get out and play more shows and there's just not enough going on kind of place. But we grew up there, got into, the reason why I wanted to play drums, actually, I remember I had a slumber party in elementary school and somebody brought over, of all things, Led Zeppelin 2.
Love it.
I don't know why. I mean, you know, it was just coincidence and it had a drum solo on it and I thought it was awesome.
Yeah.
And so I, you know, asked my parents for a drum set that year for Christmas and was very fortunate that they, you know, came through with that and started taking lessons. And Spencer, he got a bass guitar because I remember we went to pick, you know, to the drum shop to, you know, kind of pick out a kit and all that stuff. And there was a guy there that was playing bass and Spencer thought that was cool. And, you know, he's younger. I mean, he had to be like 7 at this time.
Wow.
And I remember the guy, you know, showing him how to play bass and they had a little bass, like a little one for little kids. And so my dad ended up getting that for him that same year. So he got a bass guitar and I got a drum kit and that's kind of how it all started. And then I think I was like 11, a couple years, maybe 1 or 2 years later, Nevermind came out, you know, and we just wore that thing out, you know. But I mean, it was Led Zeppelin and Nirvana for sure. And then, you know, moving into high school and getting into like punk rock and playing, you know, loving like Minor Threat and stuff like that and playing in, you know, punk bands and basements and stuff. And that kind of just like, that's how we met everyone. I mean, you know, eventually met Tyson, who would play in Sullivan and This Runs Through. That's how we all met, just playing these like, you know, like parties in high school and, you know, underground shows and, you know, house shows. And there's a little venue called Somewhere Else Tavern that was like an all ages place and anybody could play there, but it was a venue. I mean, it held like 200 people or something. And we start to sell that place out and, you know, start to earn a little bit of money selling. I mean, I think we sold t-shirts for like $7 at the time, you know, and stuff. And, just doing it and, you know, playing with some cool bands when they came through from time to time. And then, eventually, we did that for many years. I ended up going to college in Greensboro and I worked at a recording studio back when this was, when that was a thing, you know, like you could work at a recording studio. It wasn't like everybody, it was kind of before all of the online, you know,
craze.
Internet had just kind of come out, I guess, a little bit. But we did that and we the guy that owned the studio let us use it at night, you know, so we would just go in there after hours and record ourselves.
That's nice.
And we recorded, we ended up recording what became This Runs Through, 2 songs. And Tyson's parents had recently moved to the Tampa area. And that's how they had a house down there and they said that we could come down and work. We did drywall during the day for his dad in the Florida heat. And then, they let us basically stay in a room in their house. And we did that and saved up money and went on the road.
That's cool. Let's talk about this runs through for a moment. You mentioned, you know, obviously Tyson and your brother. When did you guys begin the band, and what were you? I guess what prompted you guys to say, "Hey, let's start a band," and what were the influences at the time?
We had played together in various, you know, variations of bands for a couple of years. Brooks actually from Sullivan had been a part of one or two of them at one point. Kind of like Deftones, kind of super hit influenced by that kind of thing for a little while. And then we became friends. Gosh, our friend was in a band that toured with a few, you know, God, you'll have to edit this because I can't remember. there was a band called Pint Size, and we were friends with their bass player. He ended up eventually, he was in Poison the Well for a little while.
Oh, nice.
And played with Every Time I Die for a minute. But like, you know, that guy dated one of our friends. And so we started getting into that kind of music. I remember like Opposite of December, that Poison the Well album. And, you know, we just started getting more and more into that. And we were just like, you know, we just started writing some songs like that. And then we had that opportunity to go down to Florida, and we just felt like it was a great time to completely reset our minds and like be like, okay, this is what we're going to do. You know, like we're going to go down here and we're going to try, because we've got a really good setup. We've got some songs. And so we just moved down there. We had to find a bass player, which we did, you know, very early on living down there, and we just hit the road. Really funny story. We went and we had just moved to Tampa Bay area, and we didn't know what to do. And we were kind of driving around, and we saw the Greyhound dog track, and we're like, let's go see what this is about. And I'm not kidding you, dude. We went in there and we put $18 on a bet randomly. We went down and we like looked at the dogs, like we didn't know anything about anything, and we just picked them based on the ones we thought looked the coolest or something. And we won $1,800
off
that bet. And that's literally how we bought our first van.
That's so cool.
Our touring van, we bought like an old beat up construction van. You know, the money we used for that. And then we went on that thing went on like two or three tours before it finally just completely died.
That is insane. That's so cool.
That's pretty funny. Yeah.
So you start the band. Does Indianola find you guys first, or have you already recorded the EP before that?
We had two songs, and we met a band called Sleeping by the Riverside. They were
Love them. Absolutely area. Love them. Adam.
Yeah, they were awesome. And we played some shows with them in the area, and they were on Indianola.
Okay.
And so they showed them our songs, and we had done a little bit on our own. There was a site back then called mp3.com.
Oh, yeah, I remember that.
And oddly enough, there was a site called, it was before Friendster, which was before MySpace. There was a thing called Makeout Club. Do you remember that?
Oh, yeah, I do remember that. Yeah.
And people had profiles on there, and they would list like the bands that they were into, and they would put their instant messenger tag on their profile. And we would search that site during the day and find people that liked Hope's Fall or Poison the Well or other bands that we liked.
Yeah.
And we would send just total cold call, copy paste, instant message. Like, hey, we're this band from Florida. We see you like these bands. Check us out on mp3.com. And we started doing that so much, we actually got like to number two on some chart on that site or something. So like, it was like super, you know, really early on online
grassroots spam.
Out of the box thinking, yeah. But that's what we did, and we got a bunch of plays out of it. And
that's great.
So I guess that plus we had done some touring a little bit on our own, and Sleeping by the Riverside, and we went up there and played with them in Valdosta, where that label's from.
Yeah, yeah.
And yeah, they ended up making us offer, and we went up there and recorded that EP. They had like a cabin in the woods and stayed in that and went to the Sound Studios for, I don't know, it was probably, in hindsight, I think it was probably only like 5 or 6 days, but at the time we were like, I can't believe we have to go record for five or 6 days.
I know. What was that like for you for the first time, you know, being able to go into, a professional studio, if you will?
It was awesome. You know, like it was just kind of like, we don't have to pay for this. it was really cool. And then Danny and all the guys were great. And, you know, we would, you know, hang out, and we played up there every chance we got. And, it was fun, man. That definitely kind of started to open some doors, and, you know, we started touring more.
Who were you touring with?
We did a tour with Bludgeon. Do you remember them?
Yeah, absolutely.
And they were actually from the Greensboro area where we grew up, so we knew already. And we did a tour with them. Then we ended up doing a tour with Evelyn.
Oh yeah,
from Dallas.
Yeah,
the Dallas Shane, area, which became Oh Sleeper and As I Dying.
Yeah.
So like we did like a full US with them. That tour was really fun. We didn't know them at all. And, but we had the same like booking manager guy, and, we had a van and they had a trailer. And so we just drove our dude, you know, we booked this whole tour and we had like 6 weeks, I think. We had 11 guys in a 15 passenger van with like very minimal air conditioning, you know,
that smelled
and towing a trailer. And, you know, I mean, back then, you know, it was for very little money. The shows were great, you know, like they were surprisingly better than we thought they were going to be. But, you know, we were sleeping on people's floors.
No, I get it. I get it.
I mean, yeah, 11 dudes showing up to sleep on your floor, you know, kind of thing.
That's hysterical.
It was awesome. That was a really fun time.
That's right.
Really cool.
Looking back on that EP, how do you feel about it?
I love it. That's honestly, out of all of the records we've done, I think that's my favorite artwork out of everything I've ever been on. Nice. In reality, it probably wasn't that long, but at the time, I remember waiting for the artwork and we were just like, gosh, it's just taking forever. It was like the last thing, you know, and we were just being little kids about it basically. But, so when we saw it and it was better than we were expecting, cause that's really sick. Yeah. You know, when your artwork comes in, it's like either awesome or like a letdown, you know? Yeah. And, when that artwork came in, we were like, this is super cool. So yeah, I actually love that EP. I haven't listened to it in a while, but, I love the artwork. People still to this day will send me messages on social media about it.
That's cool.
It's really, yeah, it's awesome. I mean, especially considering where we were 6 months before that or whatever, you know,
totally.
Like what all the steps that we had to take to get to that point.
Totally.
Yeah.
So, cool. So you're touring, their EP's out, you guys signed a Face Down and then you're no more. Let's talk about that.
We did. We toured. At the time it felt like a lot, and you know, in retrospect compared to the other bands we did later, it wasn't, but, we had an offer from Face Down. We had briefly talked to Solid State, but nothing serious. And we were young and we just thought like, hey, we need to do as much as we can all the time. Mm-hmm. And I think maybe, I don't know if we just like over mentally worked ourselves or something, but we came back from a tour and we had another full US tour booked, and a couple of the guys were just like,
no,
one felt like not doing it anymore. And so we had come up with the guys from Sullivan. We had played a bunch of shows with them. I moved back to North Carolina and I had been talking to that band Life in Your Way, actually.
Oh yeah. Great.
Because we had met them touring with This Runs Through, and, they were needing a drummer. And they were on Indianola also. And so I was actually learning their songs and I was going to go up to Connecticut and jam with those guys. And Brooks, the night before I was going to go, Brooks from Sullivan called me and was like, hey, we need a drummer. I just bought a van. I really want to do this. And I just really thought Brooks was a great songwriter and really liked hanging out with him and loved Zach. And it was a 3-piece at the time. And it was a totally different style of music. And I was like, man, let's do something different. You know, let's not be in a heavy band. Let's try like a pop rock kind of thing, you know?
Yeah.
And 3-piece instead of a 5-piece. Cool. You know, we don't have to tow a trailer now, you know, or whatever, you know? So yeah, so we did that, and man, Brooks and I, we ended up doing a full U.S. tour. Zach was traveling abroad at the time. We had a friend of ours fill in, and we just did a full U.S. tour, just the two of us with a fill in, and you know, just took off and just kept doing it. And that was fun. That was a fun time.
That's awesome. When did Tooth and Nail come into the picture? Had you guys been a band for a little bit, you kind of started out and kind of found your sound, I guess, per se. When did Tooth and Nail kind of come into the picture?
So we had been touring a little bit and trying to like refine the Sullivan sound and writing some new songs and stuff and build our local following and stuff like that. And, Undereth, obviously with Spencer, I remember Spencer came home and, for Christmas or something. And he came to a Sullivan practice, And we were, he brought the Undereth demos for, what became Chasing Safety.
Wow.
And we listened to them in the van. In between, we were taking a break or something and we listened to him. And then I remember he left after that and we kept practicing. And I remember, I'll never forget this. Brooks looked at me and he was like, dude, that was so good. I don't know how they're ever going to top that. Like, how could they follow that up? You know, like it was so good. And we were like, yeah, it was awesome. You know, it was really, really good. So anyway, obviously, not everybody, but I'm assuming, everything that happened to that band. After that, Chasing Safety came out and everything started blowing up for them, which was awesome to watch and be right next to. And we were friends, obviously, with them. We had done some shows with them and we were friends with some of the Beloved guys. And we were really tight with Mackenzie from His Legend and all the His Legend.
Oh, yeah. I know him. Yeah.
And we were all North Carolina guys and we actually went to play a show in Wilmington where His Legend was from or is from. And they came and hung out, we were just played a great show and super fun hanging out. And my phone rang and I was like, this is weird. It's a Seattle number, And so I walked out, this was a Riceville Beach, like a little venue in Riceville Beach. And I walked out actually on the beach and answered the phone and it was Chad Johnson. And we had sent them some demos and stuff and, Undereth guys had put in a good word and Beloved guys and His Legend. And His Legend was texting with him while we were playing that night. And he called me and he was like, man, I got to tell you, like, I didn't want to listen to your demo because I don't want to tell the singer of my biggest band that his brother's band sucks and I'm not going to sign him, And so he's like, I just didn't want to listen to it because it wasn't a conversation I wanted to have. And he's like, I just went against my better judgment because all of the guys that you're friends with had been texting me and telling me to give y'all a shot. And I really like it. And I do want to give you guys a deal. So they offered us a deal and
wow.
Yeah, it was cool. But during that time it was crazy. Like it was an awesome time to be on that label for sure.
I bet it was. Absolutely.
It was great. Yeah.
Sweet, man. So Tooth and Nail signed you guys. How soon after you signed, do you start working on Hey, I'm a Ghost? And let's talk about that record after that.
Yeah. I don't remember how long. I felt like we renegotiated that for a little while. I think it was a full year before anything actually came out, at least. It might have been longer than that. But we went and recorded Ham a Ghost with Matt Goldman in Atlanta.
He's great.
It was amazing. That was the first like real record I had ever done where we were there for like 5 weeks and everything, it just sounded awesome.
Yeah.
You hit the drum and you're like, whoa, it sounds real. And Matt Goldman's such a good drummer. I was like super intimidated the first day. Like I don't deserve to be
He's
here
so cool.
kind of thing. He is such a nice guy. I'll never forget a couple of things about Matt. I'll never forget from that first recording was the first day we got there, we went to eat lunch and he drove and he was like, I just want you guys to understand something. y'all don't deserve to be here. And it was like, you know, back in my day, you had to be the best of the best. There was no tooth and nail. You had to be the Beatles or Led Zeppelin. You know, you had to be the best of the best, you know.
I love that.
And, you know, I'm sure I'm paraphrasing and not quite remembering exactly what he said. But, you know, basically it was like, you know, you guys have a really, you know, this is an awesome opportunity kind of thing. You know, but yeah. it was super fun. And then, he asked us if we had ever seen The Incredibles, and a couple guys hadn't. So he made us watch The Incredibles before we got started. But I mean, he was in the other room, you know, like setting up drum mics and stuff. But he was like, we're not starting until you guys watch this movie. And then, the BBC office, we watched religiously recording that album. And we probably, I mean, there's only a handful of episodes of it anyway, but we probably watched that 10 times all the way through recording that. That was super fun. It was a great time.
When you recorded the record, when you finally got to hear it at the end of it, on the mains, how, what were your feelings? What were your thoughts?
It was surreal back then. I mean, you know, it sounded like a big album, you know, it sounded like something that, you know, I would go buy, you know, which is always cool. And we went up to New York to the guy that mixed it, and I should remember his studio and his name, but I can't remember. I'm not going to say his name incorrectly, so I can't remember exactly, but that was awesome. He like lived on a boat and stuff.
That's cool.
Cool. And, it was just a really fun time, you know, to go from like a, you know, like a local band, regional band that did tours every now and then, to be like, okay, we can quit our jobs now and just like go try this. Cool.
Yeah.
Let's try it.
That's sick.
Yeah, so that was awesome. It was really fun.
What did Tooth and Nail think of the record?
They pushed it really hard, I feel like.
I feel like they did too.
That first album got just a great... We were the first release of the year, I think, that year. We were the January release. So you kind of had... If I remember correctly, I don't think they put anything out in December because most labels didn't put out, you know, new releases in December because of all the holiday you know, CDs and stuff back then. And so we were the first release in January of the year. So you kind of had that lull right before that for like new releases for a couple months with that label. And so we got like some good lead time, you know, like single, you know, put out on the internet. It was we felt like a lot of people heard about it 'cause it wasn't right after some other huge Tooth and Nail band way bigger than us, you know?
Sure.
It was cool. It was really cool. And we did the Bayside tour was our release tour. And
oh, wow,
man, absolutely love those guys. That was so much fun. They were big shows. On that tour, we played the Metro in Chicago.
Crazy.
And I remember Anthony saying to the crowd that was the biggest Bayside headlining show ever.
Wow.
At that point, you know, but they were awesome. I mean, we opened the tour, Punchline was on it, and the Junior Varsity from Victory.
Yeah, I booked them.
All those bands were great. Yeah, we had so much fun. I'm still friends with a lot of those guys still.
That's cool.
Bayside kind of like, you know, showed us the ropes, and I didn't even know what advancing a show was, you know, and stuff like that, you know, and Jack taught us how to play craps, you know, in Vegas. And
that's cool.
That's still my game now, you know, whenever I get a chance to go do that, I'll go do it. But
that's cool.
That was a really, really fun tour. That was a great like release tour, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was awesome.
That's right, dude. So you're obviously touring throughout the year. How long after that do you start to work on Cover Your Eyes? And let's talk about that record for a little bit.
We did Cover Your Eyes really soon after that. It came out a year and a half later. It came out the summer of 2007. So we recorded it.
Oh, that is quick.
Yeah, we recorded it not even a year after Ham of Ghosts came out. We were in the studio already. And part of that was because Ham of Ghosts was kind of like a bunch of songs that we had on demo and stuff. We had a couple originals they're all originals, but, you know, a couple of new songs for that album. But a few of them, at least half of those songs, we had been playing at that point for a couple of years. So it kind of, you know, it sounded just like a better recording of songs we already had heard a million times.
Sure.
Sure. And Brooks had been writing some stuff. We all moved into a house together. And yeah, just like started working on stuff pretty quickly.
Where'd you put this one at?
This one we went to James Wisner in the Orlando area.
Yeah.
And he had done
Further.
The Academy is, Further Seems Forever. Yeah. He had done Chasing Safety. I think he did some Paramore stuff, like a couple songs or maybe an early album or something. I don't remember, but a bunch of bands. And basically, we weren't planning on recording that quickly, but we got a phone call or something from him, and he was like, okay, or maybe it was the label, and they were like, hey, look, you know, we want you guys to go to Wisner. He wants to do the record. However, something had moved around. Some other band had moved in their schedule. And he was basically like, you can either come now or you have to wait until, you know, like 10 more months or something.
Oof.
And we were like, well, we definitely want to go to him. And we've got some songs, like some ideas.
Yeah. And, did you write most of it in the studio, or was most of it done on the outside?
Brooks had written most of it just on an acoustic guitar, recording himself, like verse, chorus, a lot of it. We had a couple songs that we had totally jammed, you know, and written out. And then we had, but I would say probably half of that when we got there.
Wow.
I had never played drums to yet, you know, like they were just very early ideas. But, you know, I remember I wasn't even in town. This was a couple of days after Christmas. We were there for New Year's Eve, and we got the call like on like the 26th or 27th of December. And it was like, you can go now or you can wait. And I was in some other state somewhere, you know, and I was like 15 or 16 hours away. And I just got in the car and drove back, and we loaded up the van and we just headed down there. And we were like, okay, I remember we all got together beforehand. We were like, all right, look, this is kind of a extraordinary situation, and we can look at this one of two ways. We can look at this like we're not really ready and this might be a mistake, or we can decide that this is the right thing to do and we're 100% in. And we're basically like, you're either all in or we're not doing this. Like, we're not going to look back on this and think that anything other than this was awesome and a great idea. And it was, I mean, I'm super proud of that record. And my dad still listens to that record.
Yeah, I was listening to it the other day. Cause, I mean, there's a drastic difference in the songwriting, and not to slight the Ghost record. There's just a step or two up for sure. And it comes in this, you know, and not to slight Goldman, it sounds great, but yeah, the sound on it is incredible.
Yeah, I mean, and I think that's really because that was written as an album. Those songs were all written together. And we were like, had like a unified purpose, you know, whereas Ghost was cool, but it was, like I said before, it was like a bunch of demos, you know, sure. Like a bunch of songs we just re-recorded. So some of the songs were way older than others. And yeah, I think that really did help with Cover Your Eyes. Like, it felt like a full on, like real release, you know?
Totally.
And I think they did a good job with that one too, promoting that as well. And
yeah. Did they seem stoked on it on the record?
Yeah. I mean, it went really well. We got some really great opportunities. We had like an awesome publicist, so we were doing really cool stuff, and we had a bunch of like close calls, you know, different things. And, which I guess ultimately ended the band, you know, like we had a bunch of like, oh, we almost got this, we almost got that.
Sure. You know,
we got like a really great management team at the time, but we were the only band of theirs that wasn't on a major label. And so the budget difference between like what they were used to working with and what we had, you know, was kind of like, I mean, you know, what can you do, you know?
Yeah.
And so like we had a bunch of really, really awesome opportunities that almost happened but didn't. And not to say we didn't do great things on that album cycle. We did. I mean, we toured with, you know, we did the MXPX tour, and we did the Classic Crime tour. And yeah, I mean, we had some great tours. But I think, you know, if memory serves me correctly, I think there were just a few almost happened things that kind of broke the spirits of a couple guys.
I get
And yeah, I mean, I, you know, for a little while I was the only one that still played music after that. Obviously we did more releases later and, you know, and other things, but Yeah, for a little while that was it. I mean, I was the only one still playing.
How did that feel to put that band to bed?
My mindset at that time was like, well, I met a whole bunch of people. I've been doing this for a few years now, you know, between This Runs Through and Two Sullivan Records, and felt like I knew a lot of other band guys. And I was like, I'll find something, you know, yeah. I'll just do something. Yeah. And I had some meetings with some other bands and some phone calls and stuff like that. And I think ultimately what led to starting to Speak of Wolves for me was, me and my buddy Drew Folk, who's an awesome producer now, we wrote some songs together, and that ended up becoming To Speak of Wolves. And he knew Tommy from Tragic Hero, and so we just decided to try that. And
yeah,
I started that band, and I told all those guys, which actually really kind of played out many times, but I told all those guys, I was like, look, I've been a part of something that fell apart that, you know, probably shouldn't have. Mm. And so I'm not, this band is just not going to end. So like if you don't want to do it anymore, I don't care. That's fine. You know, go do what you want. But this is going to keep going with or without you, basically. That was the motto of that band, you know?
Yeah.
And it, like I said, it played out several times. I mean, there's three different singers across, you know, six releases or something. And that first EP, I'm the only person that's on it. That's
wow.
Every record, you know, that kind of thing. But, you know, that was just one of those things where I just kind of felt like I could go join something else, or I could try to start something on my own, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And that's cool.
Just decided to do that.
That's cool. So, when To Speak of Wolves started, you're talking about Tragic Hero coming into the picture. You start working on that EP pretty quickly, or is that songs that you had already written? How did that kind of come to?
So, Drew Folk and I had been jamming on some songs for a little bit. We decided to kind of put it into a full band, and he's a producer now. Excuse me. And, he's done some huge albums, you know? But he was kind of just getting started back then.
Sure.
It was very similar to This Runs Through, where we had access to a studio when no one else was using it. So we would we would be up there at, it was in a church in Greensboro, and, you know, so there wouldn't be anybody there at midnight till 6 in the morning. And that's where we would go. We would go up there and we'd record at like 4 in the morning, you know, and we ended up recording those 5 songs, and we tried out a bunch of different singers, you know, and eventually the guys that are on it, you know, were on it, and we ended up doing a tour of that band, Confide, if you remember them.
Yeah. Yeah.
And Therefore I Am, and Oceana. Okay. So that was super fun. And we did like a Warped Tour date. We had some cool stuff.
Yeah.
Some cool things happened, and kind of similar, a couple of the guys in that band, they were just kind of burned out after doing that.
Mm-hmm.
And so we had started to record what eventually became this first Solid State record. We had already gone to the studio and done some of that for Tragic. And then I had to reassemble the band basically with the record like half done.
Wow.
And so I called some friends and we jammed, and we, you know, kind of like tried a bunch of people out, ended up doing a bunch of stuff. And then we went back down there, re-recorded the songs and re-recorded, you know, recorded some new songs that we had written. And I sent it to Solid State because I was nice. Hey, this is a little bit different from what, you know, I feel like this could be something, you know?
Yeah.
And so, yeah, we negotiated with them, and we ended up jumping to Solid State, for that record. And
yeah,
that's kind of how that happened. It was all pretty quick, you know?
That's cool. Well, yeah. Let's talk about that record real quick. Myself, what is it less than?
I guess, I guess, yeah, myself letting go is what we
yeah. Yeah. Let's talk about that record. It's a great record. Love the artwork on that, too. It's cool looking.
That is cool artwork. I like that one.
Yeah, so kind of at the time, how did the recording go for, like you said, you mentioned you kind of had done that a little bit for Tragic Hero. But, you know, when you brought the new blood into the band, how was that? How was the vibe? And how did it, when you heard it finally, what were your thoughts on that?
That one, so Sullivan is tied to that record a little bit because Brooks and Tyson from Sullivan had moved to the Orlando area and they had a studio. And so when we got a recording budget to do an album with, I was like, well, why wouldn't I give this money to my friends? You know,
that's cool.
We went down there and we recorded with them and then we re-recorded with them, with the new guys. And so by that, yeah, I mean, it was awesome. We were really happy with it at the time. You know, I think it captured what it needed to capture.
Sure.
Then, we did some cool stuff with it. It was, I don't know how to put this. Let's see. You know, in hindsight, that album and the EP, in my mind, they have the same band name, but they're completely different bands. Wow. Yeah. And even there are some guys that are on Find Your Worth, Come Home, and Myself Letting Go. But it's definitely two different bands. I mean, it's, you know, once we got Gage, I feel like the band really became what it was supposed to become.
And it's
absolutely nothing against anybody that was in the band before Gage. It was just one of those things, you know, I mean, eventually the stars align and
that makes sense.
What you're looking for.
After the record comes out, obviously you're pretty stoked on it. What's the touring like for you?
We toured a bunch with, Becoming the Archetype.
I love those guys. They're great guys.
A great time with them. We did a handful of tours with those guys. We did some shows here and there with Under Oath. We never did like a full tour, but they would, you know, we did like some routing shows with them and stuff, which was awesome.
That's cool.
Between the Buried and Me and stuff like that. And those shows were great. They were awesome. We had a great time. You know, we did like Cornerstone and all the things that you do. It was really fun. I mean, you know, like that, we had like one of those shuttle bus things, you know, that we had built bunks in and had a generator. And I mean,
living the dream.
Yeah. Some shows were great. Some shows weren't. Some tours were great. Some tours weren't.
Yeah. No,
but
I get it.
Man, the memories of that time. I mean, I don't know that I've ever laughed harder in my life than those couple years. Like we just had so much fun all the time.
That's right, dude. That's cool.
Yeah.
So, touring, obviously, when do you start working on the Find Your Worth, Come Home record? And you mentioned Gage coming into the band and kind of solidifying, who To Speak of Wolves is, you know, or, you know, in your words, how long after that, the first record, do you start working on that and kind of what's the recording like with that and kind of having, the new members in that?
So the only, that record, is just Gage is the only new person on.
Oh, okay. Line. I got you.
So it was myself and Corey and Aaron are on both of those records. And we really worked really hard on Find Your Worth. We basically, Corey's parents had like an old barn on their property.
Oh, that's cool.
And they were like out in the middle of nowhere, you know, in the middle of, rural North Carolina. So we could play out there and not bother anybody. And I mean, we worked so hard on that record because we were like, we just felt like, Myself Letting Go wasn't us, you know, after touring on that for a little while and listening to it and we just, you know, it was cool, but it just wasn't what we were going for. So we worked really, really hard. We spent a lot of time in North Carolina. We spent some time in Florida, all these things like really, you know, challenging ourselves, I'm really into Tool. I love Tool. And Aaron, one of our guitar players, really into Tool. And so we would listen to stuff like that and then apply it to the songs we were writing. We're like, well, you know, what if we do this? You know, like, what if we, you know, there's some like straight up Tool parts. I mean, not exactly, but, you know, totally inspired by Tool.
Sure.
But it's this, you know, kind of whatever sound we are. And, you know, you wouldn't know it unless, you know, you A, B it and go, oh, yeah, that is the same kind of
That's cool.
thing, you know, same kind of feel. So we were just yeah, we just pushed ourselves really, really hard. And we did a tour, and Gage had joined the band, you know, quick side note of how that happened, super tight with the guys from O Sleeper for forever. And, you know, Lucas, who, you know, rest in peace.
Rest in peace. Yeah.
And he called me and was like, "Hey man, like, I know you need a singer. Iron Merch guy is your singer. I'm telling you, like, he's awesome. He does guest vocals with us every night. People love him. He's charismatic. He'd be perfect." And so I was like, "All right, yeah, send him up." And so that's Gage. Cool. And that's how he joined the band. He was our Sleeper's merch guy for a while. And, you know, flash forward to where we're writing, you know, writing Find Your Worth, Come Home. I mean, we really felt like it was our chance to really prove who we are.
Sure.
And we had done an Emory tour. We got to be direct support with Emory for like a month right before we recorded. And Matt McClellan came to the show in Atlanta. And that tour really helped us a lot. Like, our eventual booking agent saw us on that tour, and he had passed on us originally because he just didn't think, you know, that first album just wasn't his style. And then he saw us play live, and he was like, "Whoa, that record doesn't sound anything like you guys." And McClellan said the same thing. And we went back to Glow in the Dark Studios with Matt McClellan and hung out with him till like 7 o'clock in the morning. And we just laughed the whole time. And we left and we were like, "Well, he's definitely the producer, you know?" And cool. he did the next two full lengths. And he's kind of like I always viewed him as like the unofficial extra member of the band. Like, you know, he gets what we're trying to do. We have sure. so much fun recording with him, and, you know, I'd record cool. every record with him if I could. I think I just have so much fun with Matt. And
that's cool.
It always turns out cool.
When you're done with the record and you're listening to it, are you just psyched? Are you just pumped?
Yeah, that was it. We really felt like it just captured what we were trying to do. You know, it sounded like we sounded. He did a great job capturing the band. We even, like, that album, we were totally nocturnal. We slept during the day and we recorded. We started every recording.
I see a pattern here.
That's what we did, man. We recorded from midnight till 8 a.m. every night.
That's cool.
And at the time, Glow in the Dark was so busy. They had a band in there when we were asleep, and we lived in the apartment in the studio. So, like, we were sleeping and there's another band downstairs recording.
Crazy.
We would get up as they were leaving and we'd go in. That's cool. And producers would switch out and McClellan would show up. But that was cool.
Awesome, man. Well, so you go on tour after that. How is the touring for that record? Do you see increase in the size, or are you? I know you mentioned the Emory tour beforehand, but how's the touring after that?
Yeah, after that it was great, man. I mean, we always, you know, we didn't do a whole lot of headlining stuff, or we tried not to. You know, I mean, nobody ever wants to sure. do that. Really, you always want to be playing with somebody bigger than you. So, yeah, I mean, we did lots of festivals, and things really started to take off, and we were just super pumped. The band was really tight. Like, you know, I think we were just really a well-oiled machine. We brought Seth in on bass. We didn't have a bass player when we recorded the record. We felt like, we'd parted ways with our bass player before that. Let's not bring another head into the studio. You know, nobody extra to get their opinion on. We know what we want. Let's keep it like this. Aaron and Corey recorded bass. And while we were there, we reached out to Seth Webster, who at the time was in Before There Was Rosalyn, the band that was on.
Okay. Victory. Yeah.
We had toured with them and we just loved Seth. He was great. He was fun to watch. He was like the nicest and still is the nicest person I've probably ever met in my life. So he became the bass player and it was just like the perfect fit. He's now in O Sleeper, you know?
Okay.
And, yeah. And it was awesome. It was such a great time. Those couple of years, like 2010, 11, 12, we just had so much fun, you know.
That's
like
awesome.
We were just all on the same page, and
that's great.
You know, the music was tight. It was fun. Yeah, it was awesome. Really fun.
So after that record, do you guys leave Tooth & Nail, or are you, because you do the Cardigan Records EP, the New Bones EP, excuse me. How does that come about? And let's talk about that.
So Gage didn't want to do it anymore after a while. You know, we did Find Your Worth, Come Home. Similar thing, man. You know, people get burned out.
Sure.
You know, I mean, we've had so many conversations. Gage is one of my best friends still to this day. And, you know, he'll bring it up every now and then, like, man, I was just a kid. I'm sorry, you know, or whatever.
I hear this all like, the time. I hear it every episode.
Like. Yeah. And so we took, man, that was, so we, that record came out in 2012 and in 2013 we were done and we didn't do anything again until 2016. So like, you know, we had all just had regular lives. You know, I had a regular job, I was living in Raleigh at the time and, you know, playing drums here and there, but not touring and stuff. And we decided to let's do another EP and we decided to like we tried to we're like let's just do it with the internet as quickly as possible, let's just kind of let's like no hype, nothing, let's just freaking do it. So we like we made an announcement that we were getting back together and that we were going into the studio. And Cardigan Records, Shane was a friend of mine. Everything with Solid State had expired by this point. It had been a couple of years. We were like, hey, like we want to just go record this thing. We're going to put it out in like 5 days.
Whoa.
And so we recorded it. And I mean, I think it ended up being like 2 weeks, but it was really, really, really quick. We went to Warrior Sound with Al, who has done a bunch of the He Is Legend records. He's freaking awesome. We did the whole thing in I think 4 days or 5 days. And I mean, we literally the night before we were going to the studio, we were in my living room with Aaron and Andrew and their guitars and his laptop writing parts on the laptop, you know? And so we walked in the studio, very similar scenario. I had never played drums to any of these songs before because we wrote them like the night before, you know, and we did it and we did like a live, we did like Facebook Live had just come out, you know? And so we did one of those and it kind of just like, we had tons and tons of viewers, like several, like we had several hundred thousand views or something.
That's nuts.
And it didn't line up with the size band that we were. It was just kind of like a Facebook was pushing that aspect, I think at the time. And so a lot of people had seen it. And we were like, yeah, so here we are. We just finished recording and it's going to be out, you know, in like 2 weeks or something. And it did. And it was, we got really lucky. Like, you know, Alternative Press covered it when it came out or something. And it ended up being really cool. So we did a little bit of touring, some festivals on that. We had just some really cool opportunities. Our buddy, from the Color Morale sang on a track and all that stuff. And
that's cool.
It was awesome. And then, we were just starting, it's kind of similar to the Sullivan thing. We had just, it kind of like opened another door and we just kept writing and writing and writing. And we just sent some more stuff to Solid State and they were like, well, yeah, come on back. So that's what happened.
That's awesome. So let's talk about the Dead and the Shadow record. You're coming off the success of the EP and, you know, are these songs, like you said, you're writing, you're stoked on it. Do you just go in fully loaded and everything good to go? Or are you writing in the studio at all? Or
We wrote that one. Andrew's the only guitar player on that one. Aaron had stepped down at that point. So we did that one as a four piece. And Andrew and I lived in different cities, so he would write stuff and we would just kind of like email things back and forth. And
was that hard to do?
No, we had done that a little bit.
Okay.
I mean, he had a bunch of stuff written. I mean, he had written just tons and tons of riffs. He was just like cranking out, you know, song ideas. And so I'd have to ask him, but I think we had like 16 songs for that one or something.
Wow.
We narrowed it down to like 10 or 11. But when we brought all those ideas to McClellan and I remember we just listened to all of them. He was just like, yeah, no, yeah, no, yeah, that kind of thing. And then, yeah, that kind of narrowed it down. But
that's cool. Looking back on that record, how do you feel about that record?
That one is still, to this day, I still listen to it. Like Find Your Worth, Come Home and Dead in the Shadow, I think are just really, really cool. And I'm really proud of both of those. Just tried different things and
sure,
you know, happy with all the drum parts and just love them.
That's cool, man. So, any new possible To Speak of Wolves recordings? I know you said you had some other songs, or you got any shows coming up or any maybe potential record?
We, We've got some songs written. We're all doing a bunch of different things now. And some of us are parents and stuff, so it's harder to do things.
Sure. But
I think that band will always do something. I mean, it maybe not at the same level or frequency that we did it, earlier, but we played a festival last year, played a show the year before that. We did a single last year, the year before. We're group chat's still going,
That's great, man.
I think eventually we'll do something.
Yeah.
I would love to, if we could just figure out a way to put more than 24 hours in a day, I'd still be doing it.
I get it. So after all these records you've played on, I'm just curious what you're most proud of. Which record, I guess, are you most proud of in general? And maybe what's the song that you're most proud of?
I think drum-wise, I'm the most proud of Dead in the Shadow. I just think there's some cool stuff on there. It's kind of one of those things, like when someone asks me, about what I used to do, in my day job or whatever, I kind of have to like figure out, okay, am I going to show this person this like crazy To Speak of Wolves song or am I going to show them some Sullivan song, because they're both,
yeah.
I'm super proud of both.
Totally.
They're very different. I think if, looking back on the Sullivan stuff, the first song on Cover Your Eyes, F-Stop, I'll still walk around the house playing that drum part because it's in my head randomly. So that's probably the Sullivan song that I'd say sticks with me the most. I guess I'm super proud of all of them, but one.
Can't pick your favorite, baby.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah, that's a great song. That's a great start to that record in general. So that's awesome that you said that. Future, man. I know you can't read the future, but what does the future look like for you? I know you got the family and the career, and like you just mentioned, maybe some potential songs. But what does the future look like for you?
Man, just trying to live life and be happy. Whatever that balance is. If it ends up that we put out 10 more records or no more records, I'm just want to be happy with the results, but. I think from a music standpoint, I think we'll do another To Speak of Wolves EP in the next year or two. I think that's very possible. And Sullivan, every now and then, we still get offers to play stuff from time to time. So you never know. I mean, maybe we'll do something else there too. I'm always, the door's always open, like I'm always down. If I can find time to do it, I'd love to do it. From a personal standpoint, I just want to play as much golf as I possibly can. I just love playing golf and I love being outside and, not thinking about anything, that's
why I just had James, awesome. From, Osleeper on. That's all he does too. He says he plays golf all the time.
I gotta play with him sometime.
It's a new hardcore.
Oh yeah. Everybody loves golf. And that, when you're a kid. So when I was a kid, my dad played all the time and he tried to get me to play.
That's cool.
I hated it when I was a kid. I didn't want to play golf. And now that I'm, I guess I'm an adult. I don't know. But, now that I'm older, I just want to play it all the time.
That's cool. Very cool, man. Yeah. Phil, thank you so much for coming on my podcast. It's been so nice to reconnect and hadn't talked to you in so long. I know via text we do, but it's just nice to catch up and talk and just hear these cool stories and just really appreciate you taking time, man.
Man, thank you for having me. Hopefully I didn't ramble too much. I'm sure I misremembered things too, so if any of the band members need to throw edits in, just let me know. No, but it was awesome. Love talking about that stuff, and man, would love to hang out sometime. Hopefully,
yes, I would love to. Absolutely. In fact, if we go up that way, I'll let you know for sure, because that'd be really cool to see that other side of the Smoky Mountains. That's cool. So
yeah, let me know when you're here next time. Bring your golf clubs.
you will beat my ass. All right, Phil, bro, I'll talk to you soon, bud.
Okay, thanks, man.
All right, man.
Thanks for having me. See ya. Uh-huh.
Thank you to the listener for tuning in to this latest episode. I really couldn't do it without you. 50 plus episodes is pretty incredible.
you'd like to add me on Instagram and Facebook at The Rumors Are True Cast. If you'd like to like and subscribe, you know the drill. Thank you to Phil Chamberlain. Awesome conversation. So cool to catch up. Such an awesome dude. Worked with him quite a few times in the past. So just awesome to hear his perspective and his side of the story. So thank you again, Phil. Hey, guys, we've got some amazing artists on the horizon. And nostalgia, guys, it's still a heck of a drug.